A very good evening. I welcome you to this episode of The Checkpoint. My name is Lynn Komjisha, and today I'm very privileged, yes, to have our country director for UNAIDS, and that is Mr. Mubanjizi Jotham. I beg your pardon. We are looking at very interesting things ahead of 1st December, which is World AIDS Day, under the theme End Inequality, End HIV AIDS, and of course, End Pandemics. That is a very wonderful theme that the UNAIDS has come out with. The world still races to deal with, of course, the wrath of COVID-19, but HIV is still roaring, and we might have said HIV is still on the low, but no, it is still here with us. So we are looking at a lot that has been going on, and tonight we are going to look at the World AIDS Strategy 2021-2026. End inequalities, end AIDS, and still goes back. It is very key. It is a strategy for 5 years, but it's also a theme for this year's World AIDS Day. Jotham, a very good evening and welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Lynn. I'm Jotham Mubanjizi, the UNAIDS Country Director acting for Uganda. It is a privilege to again host you here. Basically, as we go into the World AIDS Day, which is 1st December, there are a number of events that are before the day. And one of them is next week, we'll have the Joint Annual Review, which is also the AIDS Scientific Meeting. And basically, it will bring scientists and all program and government and development partners to assess to see how far we've been able to move within this year. This year ending has been a rare one in terms of what it has been able to bring on the table. We've seen COVID interrupt service delivery. And also in our report that we released in July, we observed that people living with HIV and AIDS, living with HIV have more challenges, but also people living with AIDS, with HIV, the risk in terms of illness, the risk in terms of death is double if somebody gets COVID. And therefore, our challenge as we go into the 2021 What is the Day, to raise awareness and to celebrate, but also to bring global and national solidarity on how we can contribute the end of AIDS by 2030, and say what are the key things that we need to do and to ensure that we minimize the COVID, but also to ensure that we work on inequalities.
Right. Jotham, this brings me actually to the Global AIDS Strategy 2021-2026, End Inequalities and AIDS. Is this what informed this year's World AIDS Day theme? And if so, why exactly did you focus on that?
Thank you very much, Aline. In June 2021, UN member states, of which Uganda is, convened and approved or adopted the Global AIDS Strategy 2021-2025 in a high-level political engagement and declaration. Member states and head of states concurred that that's a challenge. And therefore, the key issues we've seen over the last two decades has been that we've been done well in terms of the treatment, in terms of putting people on giving them ARVs, in terms of virus suppression. But we've seen that all efforts cannot be done unless we address the issues of inequality, and we address the stigma, we address discrimination, we address human rights barriers. So the global aid strategy, its focus is that unless we end inequalities, unless we end the inequal imbalance, unless we end GBV, then we cannot be able to end HIV and AIDS. And therefore, hence the theme for World AIDS Day, which says end inequalities, end in AIDS, and end epidemics. And the epidemic came in, we had been having HIV, but COVID came in, and so we have a double epidemic. Absolutely. And we need to focus on how we address those such that we can be able to contribute to the end of AIDS by 2030.
It is good that you mention these inequalities. Now, many of these inequalities have been, of course, brought to the fore by COVID-19. We have seen that as much as there's been progress in the fight against HIV, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done. And this is world over, really. COVID-19 in our face, grappling health social services, it has exposed the fragility, of course, of these gains that have been made by the world. What next now?
Thank you very much, Lynn. What next now in the next 5 years, between actually this year and 2025, our target is more focus on addressing issues of stigma and discrimination, addressing issues of human rights such that nobody is left behind, and to ensure that whoever needs the vaccines are available and accessible, and high-level advocacy at global is done to ensure that even less developed countries, including Uganda, are able to access those vaccines and those drugs in a timely manner and that are cost effective. So that's where our push is. And what we have done in the country of Uganda is to domesticate the global aid strategy. The government of Uganda, which was part of approval for the global aid strategy, has been able to align their national HIV strategic plan with the global aid strategy to focus more on issues of stigma. We've had young girls and adolescent girls getting a high rates of teen pregnancies. Those are social imbalances that we must head on in the coming 5 years to be able to curb the epidemics. And when we do that, then we'll try to end AIDS by 2030.
Absolutely. I'm glad that you mentioned the adolescent girls that have been getting pregnant. We notice this is a social structure barrier, and because there's a lot of poverty, how do we bridge this in support of HIV prevention? We're asking this because we have seen an increase in the number of teenage pregnancies, like we have said, during the lockdown, and the girls often say it is within the search for survival that men have lured them into unwanted sex. Should we blame social structure barriers like poverty, or do we have a huge gap in teaching us our teenage girls and the HIV AIDS pandemic?
Lynn, as it's a crisis, as a father, As a person who has the sisters and aunties and girl child, once these girls get pregnant, exactly what we've been able to see, the chance of them returning back to school is close to minimal. Their ability to socialize, their self-confidence is eroded, and their bodies are still young. Actually, they are child mothers. So there is a lot of crisis. But over the years, we've seen that when they were in the school proved to have been the safe environment for them. And therefore, we had less cases of teenager pregnancy during that period. But when the children and our sisters and our daughters went back home, we've seen that home has not been safe either. I call for two actions. One, the role of the family, the parenting, ability for the family to be able to articulate and look in the eyes of their daughter and say, this is a challenge, this is a problem, and this is how we need to protect. It is time also to say, can they have protection for those who can? So I want to call it upon the family, the role of the family, to be able to protect this, to be able to push for this, and not abandon the children, because what they go to do, the parents to work and leave the children without talking about this, that remains a challenge. If the parent, if then you cannot be able to open up to your daughter, get appropriate counselors who can get these daughters, and they talk to them about the issues of sex. As a country and as the United Nations in this country, we've been pushing for comprehensive sexuality education, and not talking about sex alone, but to give these children the life skills they can be able to negotiate and say no to sex, or when and how. And that is still our push. As the schools open next year, there will be more interventions within the school setting to continue doing that. But we've seen that it is the home, it is the uncles, it is the neighbors that are doing that. And we are calling upon the family to take more responsibility. As government does its own role, but there is a need for the family setting to be able to do it. I end on that. When we are young, our parents and our community, our uncles, were a bit strong. They would hold us accountable on where you're coming from, at what time you're going home. But these days, my apologies, parents have left it. And if a girl is at the university, they think she has done it all. So I want to call upon the families and the parents in particular to open up and look in the daughters in their eyes and say, that's not right. This is how you need to do it. If you want to do sex, this is how it is done. You need protection sex. You need sex that is protected. That's my comment.
It's very challenging because our teenage girls and boys especially are very aware of what's happening around them. They know these things. It's just that I haven't figured out where is the problem. But you mentioned it is the parents. They need to follow up. But the globe is changing. And these children will not be held down. They have rights. I've seen children go to courts of law and saying, you know, my mother is beating me too much. My father is doing ABCD. How are we supposed to go back to tradition and hold our children down or not?
Thank you very much, Lynn. Yes, there are rights, but also we know that the total population of the adolescent is high and therefore calls for more systems on how we can be able to address this. But in my view and in my opinion, is that let the parents do what they are supposed to do. Let the school system do what they are supposed to do. Let the university system be able to do what they are supposed to do. And let the workplace be able to do what they are supposed to do. In view, a combination of all those will be able to model our young people to be the citizen that we want, the mentorship that we have. At a time we talk about the discrimination, we've seen that at the places of work, the issues of stigma and discrimination center more because even the employers or the bosses are more sexually abusing the young people that come for mentorship. That's and we right. need to blame that.
That's right.
The home is not safe, the workplace is not safe when you're doing internship. So we need to blame that. And I'm sure that the media like you are best pressed, your voice on every other day to say, parents don't do it. Because who does it? It is a man like Joseph who has money. So blame it. And ultimately, we'll be able to make a breakthrough.
I like that you mentioned money because according to a survey done by Uganda Bureau of Statistics, 69% of the people in Uganda are on the verge of slipping back into poverty, while 21% are below the poverty line. How is this situation likely to affect the HIV/AIDS fight, given the COVID-19 pandemic that has affected our resilience? And of course, with this poverty, we are seeing that our girls, this is where our teenagers are getting excuses of, we are looking for money, this person is offering me some money, and parents are busy looking for money to take care of these children. With poverty at such a level, what ought to be done to bridge the gaps?
Thank you. Yes, COVID has made it worse in terms of our capacity for systems to be able to address and offer integrated services. But our development partners have moved the journey to support during the bad times. And that we must say thank you to our development partners that have been able to bring money, that we can be able to offer ARVs, that we can be able to offer prevention integrated services. So we need to say thank you. But also what we need to say is that both in short and medium term, the economy will struggle. But we have a hope that come January when there is opening up and about 1 or 2 years down the road, that things will stabilize. But before we stabilize, I think what needs to be done, especially for our response in terms of the boss health and whatever, We need to continuously engage the government, civil society and media. We need to continuously engage such that we can have a sustainable, resilient, integrated systems that can stand a shock. Because today we have COVID, the other year we had Ebola, another epidemic will come. So we need our systems to be able to be robust enough to address and be able to withstand any shock that will come by.
We just need to be ready, but we noticed that that readiness takes some time. When COVID happened, of course, we saw many nations grappling here and there, touching here and there, trying to stabilize. World over, poor countries especially, in Africa, Uganda inclusive, are grappling with the lack of adequate funding. Yes, and attendant resource gaps in the health sector. You're saying we need to engage and then prepare for any other eventualities. With those in place, how are we going to do that?
Thank you, Lynn. I think there is, all is not lost.
Mm-hmm.
There is some hope. Okay. And the global aid strategy offers hope.
I like that.
With HIV, we've been in it for the last 40 years.
Yes.
We've learned our own lessons. When we had the first HIV cases in Rakai, in those many years, people died like nothing. And what we've learned from that one is that that resilience of people dying like that, as it were, in Rakai, we've been able to learn with HIV, and that communities, once they are empowered, once the communities are educated, then they would be able to identify the triggers and be able to say there is a problem here and we can be able to address this one. The second one on how we are able to learn from this one is that countries like China and others have been able in the short time to put up some infrastructure that can be able to move up. But also in Uganda, we've seen some kind of coping mechanism. We've seen Mulago, we've seen Nambole, we've seen other places turned into some mean shift health facilities which have been able to support this one. We've also seen upgrading over in Entebbe Referral Hospital to offer some COVID-related interventions, and Entebbe Referral Hospital is now at the first class in terms of addressing and handling the COVID cases.
There have been concerns that it was mishandled.
Yes. Those misconcerns will keep continuing, but I think we look at a greater effort. If you look at Uganda, with many challenges, but the COVID-related cases have not been as high. And in part because of the governance, in my view, we can do better. But the government, in terms of trying, let us make Entebbe, let us make Nambore, let us improve Mulago Hospital and push other services, and we dedicate it for the COVID-related. I think there have been an effort. I think what we need to do is to say thank you for what we've been able to do, and we demand for more. Who would demand for more? The United Nations, the media like you, the civil society, and the political leadership. And we ask for accountability for the money that comes in. I think that's critically important. If we raise $1 for buying of the ARVs, for buying of the COVID vaccine, then it must be followed up. We need to ensure that the civil society is at the forefront, held the government accountable to say and make their voices loud and clear. And what is the offers an opportunity for civil societies to voice, say, government, thank you, you've done this, but we need more from this area.
Absolutely. Let's also talk about this vaccines charity. We are seeing that these countries, especially Uganda, let's focus on Uganda for a bit. The response to epidemics like HIV, people have been saying, we have COVID-19 vaccine very quickly. We don't have an HIV vaccine. That aside, take note of that. And we are now seeing that poor countries are just at the mercy of the vaccines charity. You know, already the HIV one, we moved on. We're saying the world said we cannot make that one, but we have COVID-19 vaccines in place. And the charity is my biggest worry. You know, poor countries are having challenges accessing vaccines. The other day, politicians were, pointing fingers at our leaders and saying, you are not doing enough to get us vaccines. The leaders are saying, we are doing our best to get vaccines, and we hope you can, you know, follow up on what we are doing. But do you think enough has been done in that area?
Thank you. The issues of vaccine charity, and it has been a global issue. And our UNAIDS executive director globally has been a call for to have vaccine for all. That whether you're in America, whether you're in Sri Lanka, or whether you're in Uganda, you are a human being. And we do not need that you produce vaccines and you hold them for your own country, where in country X people are on a second or third job, and in Uganda, majority of them have not been. So there have been a lot of advocacy for that. And that, in a way, has been able to pay off. The head of state for this country, His Excellency President Yoweri Museveni, he made a call recently in Abuja to say, guys, we need this. When there is a refugee crisis, Uganda will stand up in solidarity, we help. But when there is jobs, you do not stand with us in solidarity. And I think there have been a change of heart. And that's why you've seen in the last two, three weeks, we've been able to receive many COVID jobs dropping into the country. Mm. What we require is a continued and sustained advocacy on things that we cannot generate and produce as a country, and have this one both at country, regional, and global level. Mm. That way, we'll be able to hold the most developed countries accountable, such that the support to every human being, irrespective of where they are, is the same, and hence the call for vaccination, vaccine for all. And no one is safe until we are all safe. And therefore, if you do not have a Ugandan vaccinated and they go to America, or they will either be denied, or whenever the Americans come here, then they will get contamination and whatever. So I think pushing for vaccination for all and ensuring that no one is safe and unless we are all safe, I think is a big drive for all of us to be able to move forward.
Now, Jotham, allow me ask you this question. Many Ugandans have been asking, why was it easy for the world to come up with a COVID-19 vaccine, but the HIV/AIDS vaccine is nowhere?
Okay. Thank you very much. That's a very good question, Lynn, and it borders in the area of science.
Yes.
It borders in the areas of science. And I will provide one response and leave the others for other scientists. The COVID, as you've seen, has been more around like how we get the airborne diseases. Mm-hmm. Okay?
A little bit
of that one. And therefore, there have been a deliberate effort. Even the Professor Gwanga in this country, Uganda, we may ask why he has not ventured the drugs for HIV. But maybe through enhancing of immunity, because you see how even leader of opposition, Besigye, how they have been saying, get these concoctions, ginger, lemon, honey, make them, and when you take them, then your body immunity is enhanced. And once it is enhanced, once you get this COVID, you are not as weak as the other one. The story is different with HIV and AIDS, and that will be for another day.
Are you serious?
Yes.
I thought you were going to give us the other story of the HIV.
The other story of the HIV requires is for science, and I'm not.
Well, viewers there, I hope you don't worry so much about that, because I think the world over, scientists over, I think, have tried their best and they're still trying their best to come up with an HIV vaccine. But away from that, Jotham, drawing key lessons, of course, learned from the intersecting HIV and COVID pandemics, what new ways does this new strategy introduce in the approach to HIV response, say, in identifying where, why, and for whom the HIV response is not working?
Okay. Thank you very much. Globally, and in and Eastern Southern Africa, and in Uganda,
yes,
we've done well in areas of treatment. Take the refill consistently, and you ensure you suppress the virus in your body, not transmit. We've done that one very well.
Yes.
Where we've not done well are three areas. One, the human rights issues, the key populations, most of these countries, including Uganda, do not have an open hand that these key populations can be able to freely get services, associate, and talk and be able to move on. But yet we know that more than 2 times of the new infections, they happen within those key populations. And just I'm in the evening, I pass through Sheraton, or I pass through whatever, or am I bisexual? So there's a time I have a sex with a man, at evening I have sex with my wife.
Maybe just to cut you short, I'm sorry. Key population, who are these key population? Who are you talking about?
Okay, thank you. In this country and globally, the key population are basically men who have sex with men.
Okay.
Sex workers, mm-hmm. transgender, and people who inject drugs.
Why are they key?
Okay, and because then we also have the priority groups, population group, priority groups, mm-hmm. and those are like adolescent and young girls. Yeah. We also have the fishermongers, mm-hmm. but and also we have especially some of the vulnerable women.
Yeah.
Okay. The other one, we call them the key population, because not the general population, they are key population. What we've seen is that they are not fully recognized in our country legal laws, but then the science and evidence has shown that
they are at a
greater risk of transmission of HIV and AIDS. Mm-hmm. And unless we address or we have interventions to reach those men who have sex with men, sex workers, the transgender, the people who inject drug users, then we'll do the as a general population, but this will keep on infecting. Because it is me, it is the other, it is Peter, it is Lynn. During the day, maybe has sex with, is a transgender. In the evening, it is heterosex. And the infection keep going on. And therefore, our focus for this global AIDS strategy is to say, while we've done well with the other treatment, we need to address the issues of human rights such that whether you're transgender, an MSM, or sex worker, you should be able to receive the same treatment and prevention services as another general person. And also, secondly, the strategy focuses also on ending issues of stigma and discrimination. I talked about the stigma at the workplace. I talked stigma within the people living with HIV and AIDS. I talk about the stigma with also within the places of worship. Mm-hmm. Those are the major challenges we have. And therefore, if I come to you and I want to disclose to you, you are my boss, Lynn. If I come to disclose to you and you say, I have HIV, you say, what? Do you have HIV? What is it? No, now be home, be whatever. Then the other day, Jane, who is also your coworker, will not open it up. And we'll keep it, so I will come here, I will not take my ARV, I will not anything. Every other day I will be weak, because my body will be weak. Yeah. And therefore I will go home. And because I've not taken the treatment, if I have sex with another person, then the chance of transmitting the HIV will be high. And that is where we have failed as a country globally to be able to achieve the target. But we hope if we address that one, such that I'm able to come to you and I say, my dear, I tested, I'm HIV positive. I'm able to tell my partner, I'm HIV. I'm able to convince my family, say, I'm HIV positive, kind of support me to take my ARV such that I can be able to minimize the transmission rate. Then that way we'll be able to make a breakthrough.
Wonderful. You mentioned human rights issues. What human rights? What human right, for example, does an HIV positive person have that we might not know? We probably, like you've said, if I walk up to you and say, you know what, I am HIV positive and you take off, I don't know what human right you have violated.
Okay, I will focus the aspect of human rights, especially as it relates to the key population. As you may know, in 2012 of 2013, this country, Uganda, there was passing of Anti-Homosexuality Act, that if you are caught, you are arrested as by the penal code, and so you don't associate. And currently, as we talk, one of the bigger crisis issues that we have is that if they find you and they anticipate that and they suspect that you are men who have sex with men in a certain gathering somewhere, they take you the prison. One of the things they dictate first, they take you because you are breaking COVID restrictions or SOPs. But when you reach in the prison, you know what they do? They first do an examination. Say, if you are MSM, have you been praying sex? And then that is demeaning for the police officer doing that test, but for also a gentleman already opening up and they say they are doing that examination. It should be done by, it should be done if I have the sickness for that. But they shouldn't arrest me in where we are associating and it is taken. That, those are the issues that rate the human right. They abused my right. They have met us as 20 and they have taken us to prison. And the next day they are doing is an examination. That does not rate with the SOPs of the COVID SOPs. And that should be blamed with all that care to know.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, Uganda, let's look at Uganda. What is your take on Uganda's efforts towards the Global AIDS Strategy 2021-2026?
Well, I think, Lynn, we've done well.
Oh.
Yes. We've done well. Uganda is one of the 8 countries globally that have achieved at 90-90-90. That means you have 90% of the people living with HIV, not their status. 90% of the people living with HIV are on treatment, and 90% of the people living with HIV, have virus suppressed that they cannot transmit HIV. We've done well.
That's very interesting. How have we done that?
We've done well because through the scaling up of the treatment literacy. Currently, out of 1.4 million people living with HIV, 1.3 million people are on treatment. That's very great. So we have a gap of about 100,000 people. Also, we've been able to do these prevention services that have gone on, have seen that we've been able to reduce our new HIV infections by about 60% during the last 10 years. But also AIDS-related deaths, people are no longer dying very frequent as it were. We've reduced also AIDS-related deaths by about 61%. Okay? So we've done that one. So in terms of where we are, in terms of the global strategy, you've done it, but there is an unfinished business.
I want you to hold on to that unfinished business. Yes. And also convince me that we have done well since COVID started in Uganda, March 2020. I don't quite believe you there that we have done well in this period. But I can't wait to hear from what you have to tell us and how we have done it. We take a break right now. When we return, it is Checkpoint.